welcome to Jay Coletti's Racket Reviews. My name is Jay Coletti, and I will be your hostess. Here on Racket Reviews, we're dedicated to learning about all things organized crime, and I'm very excited to start another individual conversation with you today, talking about Gus Alex, a notorious Chicago outfit mobster who, for the first time in our individual studies, was a non-Italian. He was Greek, though, so his ancestors did share a spice palate with Italians. If Gus Alex is not the man that you recommended that I do an investigation on today, don't worry, I have a running list, so please keep commenting who you'd like me to research. Today was focusing on Gus Alex because he was one of the most requested mobsters to cover. We have much to discuss, so let's get right to it. Gus Alex was born in Chicago, Illinois, to a Greek immigrant couple, Nicholas and Christina Alex. It is very likely that their last name was Americanized upon the couple's immigration. Alex was born on April 1st, April Fool's Day, in 1916, but despite his birthday, Alex was no joke. As mentioned at the beginning, Alex was not an Italian, and as you'll recall from previous videos, non-Italians were not permitted to be made men in Cosa Nostra. In fact, at the time of Alex's birth, the issue of non-Sicilians even joining a family was hotly contested. A Greek man had no chance. However, there were other avenues for enterprising criminals to harness the mafia's power. As with many men's hearts, the best way to get into a mobster's inner circle is through his stomach. Bruno Roti, the first man to become the capo of the outfit's 26th Street crew, opened a tavern that doubled as his headquarters on 26th Street called Phil's Liquors. However, as the tavern grew, he and his friend Nick Alex, who was apparently an excellent cook, opened a restaurant together that became a regular haunt for Al Capone and Frank Nitti. In addition to Capone and Nitti, one of Capone's Jewish associates, Jake Cusick, was a fan of Nick Alex's cooking as well. Not only was Gus Alex's father involved in the Chicago outfit, but his big brothers Sam and George were as well. During the Prohibition era, Sam Alex worked with Capone's main security detail and was one of Capone's top hitmen, even earning the nickname Sam R.I.P. Alex. Sam and George were also politically involved and ran the city's hoisting engineer unions. Gus Alex was involved during this time as well, but there isn't much information on him during this time. It is assumed that he worked under his brother Sam, who seemed to be the leader of the Alex brothers. At the time, he dropped out of school in 1930. Gus Alex wasn't sitting on his hands in school. By 1930, he was already a suspect in 5 unsolved murder cases. Gus Alex really secured a spot on the authorities' radar when he was arrested in a bar fight at the age of 19 on September 24, 1933. When the officer searched his car, they found multiple sawed-off shotguns, a telltale sign of outfit involvement. In 1936, Sam Alex, who had begun to draw media and law enforcement attention to the outfit, was told to leave the city. He would purchase a farm in Michigan, from where he would have his little brothers run his operation for him. On October 22, 1937, Gus Alex was arrested for multiple robberies but was acquitted when the witnesses said that they could not identify him as the culprit. After working as a truck driver for a mobbed-up family business of one of his friends in Cicero, he would get into trouble on February 22, 1940, when he struck a man with his car, killing him. The charges would be dropped on April 17, 1940. In 1942, Alex opened an illegal gambling establishment, but it would be raided the next year, leading to his arrest. On May 6, 1943, Alex would be acquitted and the gambling equipment confiscated in the raid was ordered to be returned to him. Alex's major inroads into the Chicago outfit came from Jake Cusick. Cusick, the outfit's financial and legal advisor, who was a fan of Gus Alex's father's cooking, would take Alex under his wing. In 1943, Alex would be working with Cusick's men, running a successful illegal gambling operation. Alex was drafted in 1944, but was able to produce medical paperwork showing that he was too mentally unstable to serve. This was a common practice by mobsters in World War II. However, in Alex's case, this might have actually been the truth. More on that a little later in this video. But whether it be through mental incapacity or alleged physical injuries, mafiosi were, unsurprisingly, notorious draft dodgers. In November of 1944, Alex would be brought in for questioning about the shooting of a man in 1943, but he was released. Alex was suspected of another murder on August 2nd, 1947, where the victim's brother pointed to Alex as the culprit. Alex was brought in for questioning and, you guessed it, was released without charges. During this time, Alex was working under Cusick at Atlas Brewing Company, which had been mob-owned since Johnny Torrio was boss. Using Cusick and his connections, Alex would help secure political influence for the outfit through means of bribery and, by the mid-1940s, would be the top liaison between the outfit and City Hall. He would control the Chicago Loop's gambling and prostitution operations. Many of these prostitution rings were run out of prominent downtown hotels, with some call girls being paid up to $1,000 per night. Alex was a very big earner for the outfit, bringing in about $1 million of revenue per month. In the late 1940s, Alex eloped with his fashion model fiancée, Marion Ryan. they were married in Las Vegas, which was fitting as Alex was a man who made his riches from illegal gambling and would go on to have some say in the outfit's Vegas operations. On November 24th, 1953, Gus Alex, Jake Usick, and Murray Humphreys were all arrested in the Solano Tavern shop and questioned about their associates and connections to the outfit, but were released without charges. Gus Alex was one of the main targets of law enforcement if they weren't in his pocket. Many times, in order to avoid corruption, several of these outfit members would not be caught until the federal government got involved, and even then, they were slippery. After nearly a decade of trying to lock him down and lock him up, Senators Robert F. Kennedy and John McClellan had secured an appearance from Alex in Washington. On July 31st, 1958, he was called to Washington and questioned. Alex had dyed his hair gray around the temples and wore dark glasses. During his appearance before the Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations of the U.S. Senate Committee on Government Operations, Alex would refuse to answer questions about the outfit by pleading the Fifth Amendment over 39 times. Robert Kennedy said the following about Gus Alex and Frank Ferraro, his friend and partner in crime on several occasions. Gus Alex and Frank Ferraro are two of the most ruthless and vicious hoodlums with complete control over Chicago's First Ward. In July of 1959, during Paul Rica's trouble with tax evasion and his court cases, Murray Humphreys and Gus Alex used their crooked detective agencies to spy on jurors in order to help in Rica's case. In November of 1959, the FBI came out aggressively against the Chicago outfit, planting listening devices in the Solano Tailoring Shop and in a Forest Park tavern. They weren't about to let the outfit wriggle out of their grasp again. In 1960, Mary and Alex told her husband that she wanted a divorce. She had looked the other way for years regarding his work, but the couple fought constantly, and she lost her patience. She had wanted him to get out of the outfit, but he didn't listen, opting to beat her, cheat on her, and argue with her instead. He had almost killed her before when she had threatened to leave him forever, but in 1960, she was able to get away from him. He already had trouble with his heart and insomnia, and these marital problems exacerbated the issue. He was a worrier and would have nervous breakdowns, high blood pressure, and paranoia. He was even committed to a sanitarium in Connecticut where he would be prescribed a regimen of rest and Thorazine, an extremely powerful antipsychotic medicine used for conditions such as schizophrenia. He once told his friend Ferraro, "I took 13 vitamins. I don't go nowhere, just to cross the street to eat and lay on the couch. I bought $2 worth of Quarter Cowboy books. I just laid around. I ate, slept, and just rolled over." In the very early 1960s, Alex seemed to be part of the outfit's Las Vegas team as he, alongside Sam Giancana, met with Mo Dalitz multiple times regarding Las Vegas interests. Gus Alex had the following to say about Las Vegas. "It's a sucker's game. You can't win out there, you understand? We got the percentages rigged all in our favor. The longer you stay, the more you play, the more chances you got of losing. I don't let nobody around me who gambles. A couple thousand, okay, but no gambling." By the end of 1962, Alex began traveling to Europe to handle the outfit's international interests and money laundering operations. In the mid-1960s, now a bachelor, he became very close with Jewish mobster Eddie Vogel, and the two spent much of their spare time at the Playboy Club, where the club's general manager, Arnold Morton, who would go on to become a successful restaurateur with Morton's Steakhouse, always supplied the two men with their most exclusive women. This is where Alex would begin dating a Playboy bunny named Susan Fugger. If you've never read Gloria Steinem's expose on the Playboy Club, I highly recommend that you do so. These women were essentially prostituted out for drink and merchandising sales, and their success was measured by how much money they got these men to spend. The women would be demerited or paid less based on such things as chewing gum, messy hair, bad nails, and bad makeup. Their manual included instructions and advice such as, "You are the only direct contact most of our readers will ever have with Playboy personnel. We depend on our bunnies to express the personality of the magazine. Bunnies are reminded that there are many pleasing means they can employ to stimulate the club's liquor volume, thereby increasing their earnings significantly. The key to selling more drinks is customer contact." In addition, despite Hugh Hefner and many managers claiming that this was not a prostitution ring, these women were subjected to STD testing and gynecological exams to ensure that they were clean. Alex borrowed Vogel's Playboy companion on occasion, but was officially dating Susan Fugger. He showered her with gifts of furs and jewelry and showed her off to many of his criminal associates. He was proud to have her. Vogel, Alex, and their girlfriends took lavish trips to Europe, including annual ski trips to Switzerland, until Alex was banned from going to Switzerland as he was a known criminal. Vogel, Alex, and their girlfriends moved in together in an apartment back in the United States. Alex always wore expensive suits and kept himself fit to keep up with Fugger and all of the other women he was sleeping with. In the winter months, they would stay at Miami Beach in $100 a day suites and go to parties. Alex kept several models on staff for his entertainment and relied on his abortionist doctor, William Nestos, to make sure that he never had to deal with any sort of unwanted consequence of this lifestyle. All of this, coupled with the FBI's constant pursuit of Alex, flared up his anxiety, Fortunately for him, he was able to medicate those concerns away to keep up with the lifestyle that he created for himself. He married Fugger in 1968, and this of course did nothing to stop his philandering. Alex would spend many a night with his pal Vogel at ritzy establishments with expensive escorts. According to FBI records from 1971 to 1975, Alex had worked his way up into the ruling panels of the Chicago outfit. He was on the decision boards with Joey Iuppa and Tony Accardo. This was a role Alex took reluctantly. He wanted to stay out of such direct connections to the outfit. In 1971, Alex, forever anxious, worked through messengers who would deliver messages for him and never mention his name in front of anyone who wasn't part of the outfit. In 1972, Alex and several others were questioned before a special federal grand jury about racketeering involvement, along with police and political corruption. Nothing came of it. In 1974, Iuppa, who was suffering from painful arthritis in his knees, would actually leave Gus Alex to briefly take his place on the outfit's ruling panel, with Alex's brother Sam being the messenger between the two of them. I just want to reiterate this again because it is so rare that someone would rise up so far into the outfit without any Italian heritage. The only two men who were above him were Tony Accardo and Joey Iuppa as far as importance and respect. Into the 1980s, Alex earned even more money from getting cuts of some of the outfit's most ruthless loan sharking operations ran by Lenny Patrick, and would also assist in the outfit's day-to-day operations with Iuppa's underboss Sam Carlisi after his boss was put away on skimming charges. In 1987, Gus Alex's brother Sam Alex was diagnosed with cancer of the larynx. Soon after, Alex found his brother Sam dead in the bedroom where he had shot himself. The beginning of the end came for the 76-year-old Alex when Lenny Patrick testified about his involvement in the outfit. It was all because of one street crew, Lenny Patrick's crew, that Alex finally received justice. He was found guilty by the federal jury for the violent extortion of business owners on October 1st, 1992. He was sentenced to 15 years and 8 months with a fine of $823,000 in February of the following year. Gus Alex would die of a heart attack while confined to a federal prison medical center in Lexington, Kentucky, on July 24th, 1998, at the age of 82. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Racket Reviews talking about one of the Chicago Outfit's most influential associates. A troubled man with a mixed sense of purpose, Gus Alex was certainly an interesting study. Don't forget to let me know if you have someone that you would like for me to study. I'm happy to investigate for you. Make sure to like, subscribe, and click notifications to get more Mafia contents and directly to your sub box. Ciao.